हेलो एवरीवन एंड वेलकम टू आईवीएसए बीदर्स ऑफिशियल यूट्यूब चैनल पशुवाणी। पशुवाणी इज अ प्लेटफॉर्म दैट प्रोवाइड्स यू विद वेटरनरी एजुकेशन। आर वीडियो सीरीज कंसिस्ट्स ऑफ प्रैक्टिकल रेलेवेंट लेक्चर वीडियोस, फील्ड अप्रोच क्लिनिकल एस्पेक्ट्स, गाइड एंड टिप फॉर फ्यूचर करियर्स, स्मार्ट कंटेंट रिलेटेड टू बोथ एनिमल एंड वेटरनरी साइंस। वी बिलीव शेयरिंग इज केयरिंग, सो प्लीज लाइक, कमेंट एंड सब्सक्राइब फॉर फर्दर अपडेट्स। एंड नाउ Let's welcome a speaker of today's episode of Saturday's Sharing.
Good morning, dear students. Today, we are going to look into one of the important disease of dogs, canine ehrlichiosis. Now, canine ehrlichiosis is not a new disease. Look at the second slide. The first report of canine ehrlichiosis dates back in 1935 from Algeria. But it took a little bit of time to understand the canine ehrlichiosis because most of times the disease was confused with babesiosis. Okay, so actually the disease came to more importance during Vietnam War, when the US Army were using their military sniffer dogs for landmines, detection of landmines. That time suddenly a new type of disease was recorded in dogs. These dogs used to become lethargic. They were not doing the actual job of sniffer, what was expected from them. And many dogs, they became sick. And that was a worrisome factor. So there, during that time, it caused widespread deaths also in military sniffer dogs. So that time it came to the prominence. And for many years, the disease was thought that it is of zoonotic importance and it is being transmitted to human. But the first report of human ehrlichiosis was recorded in 1986, and it was very well understood that the etiological agent of human ehrlichiosis is different from that of canine ehrlichiosis, and the curtain on zoonosis was drawn. So it is now clearly understood that canine monocytic ehrlichiosis is different from human ehrlichiosis. Okay, in India, the first report dates back in 1958. Okay, but again the disease came into prominence in India during the large scale, again the infection occurring in sniffer dogs of the Indian military, which was mobilized as an Indian peacekeeping force, IPKF, which went to Sri Lanka during that conflict of the LTTE and the Sri Lankan government. So as a the support, IPKF was formed, and they carried their sniffer dogs again for the same purpose of detecting landmines in the Sri Lanka. So during that time, actually the disease came into prominence in India, and the Madras Veterinary College did a pioneer work in identifying the cause of deaths in military dogs of Indian Army, and it came out to be the canine ehrlichiosis. This is the history and background of canine ehrlichiosis. Now let us come down to etiopathogenesis. First let us look into the etiology of canine ehrlichiosis. So we have to understand that the canine ehrlichiosis is caused by two organisms, out of which this Ehrlichia canis, which causes canine monocytic ehrlichiosis, is the prominent organism, and that is the one which is actually causing the canine ehrlichiosis in Indian subcontinent. Okay, one more organism is also causing a type of ehrlichiosis, that is caused by Ehrlichia platis, canine cyclic thrombocytopenia. Okay, so it is not of that importance. So what we are going to look into canine ehrlichiosis is the canine monocytic ehrlichiosis, which is caused by Ehrlichia canis. And all of you know that Ehrlichia, they are rickettsial organisms, and these rickettsial organisms, by their size, they fall between the viruses and the bacteria. The viruses they are smaller than rickettsia, and the other microorganisms which are categorized as bacteria, they are larger in size than the rickettsia. So they fall in between. And the peculiarity of canine ehrlichiasis is they are intracellular type of organisms, and that's why it took little bit of time in understanding their pathology and how they multiply, how they cause the damage to different organs. And now much of the pathogenesis is very clear what canine monocytic ehrlichiasis causes. The other synonym, the alternative name for canine monocytic ehrlichiasis is canine pancytopenia. Okay, so the name itself indicates that canine pancytopenia means it decreases all cellular contents of the blood, and that's why it is called as pancytopenia. Cytopenia is nothing but decrease in the number of cells. Okay, so pancytopenia means all types of cells in the body, they go down. So previously, now also, you know, some people they refer it as canine pancytopenia, but the correct terminology of canine ehrlichiasis is canine monocytic ehrlichiasis, because monocytes, they are the prime cells where the ehrlichia organisms they harbor, and they cause much of the damage. Okay, now I just told you that the human ehrlichiasis is also has been reported. So the causative agent for human granulocytic ehrlichiasis is Ehrlichia chaffensis, and it is altogether different, though the genus is same, but it is altogether different ehrlichiasis, and canine ehrlichiasis is nowhere related with human granulocytic ehrlichiasis. What is the transmission? Transmission of ehrlichiasis is through the vector. Okay, so it is a vector borne disease, and they have identified Rhipicephalus sanguinis is the major tick responsible for transmission of ehrlichiasis, though there are reports that Dermacentor and Amblyomma species have also been documented to transmit canine ehrlichiasis. But the primary agent, primary vector responsible for transmission of canine ehrlichiasis is Rhipicephalus sanguinis. Okay, let us go to the next slide. Continuing the etiopathogenesis, it has been well documented now. You know, the vector-borne transmission, you have to understand whether what type of transmission takes place. They call it as transterial type of transmission, means stage to stage. You know, the ticks, they grow from, you know, nymph to lymph, then to the adult, larva, nymph and adult, like that. Okay, so from stage to stage. So one stage only will be infected, and it keeps on transmitting from one stage to the other. So that is called as transterial transmission. The other type of vector-borne, some of the vector-borne diseases, they are transovarian, means from mother through the egg, the disease is also transmitted. But here it has been observed that it is only transmitted from stage to stage. From one stage to the other stage, the Ehrlichia organisms, they are transmitted. And the same thing what you have seen in babesiosis, you know, the tick attaches to an infected dog, then it sucks the blood in the gut of the tick, the organisms are separated, and from there the Ehrlichia, they are transmitted to the salivary gland. So when this tick again bites to a healthy dog, through the salivary secretion, these organisms, they are injected into a healthy host. So this is how the cycle is completed, in from tick to the host. Okay, infected host sucking of the blood, then the Ehrlichia organisms from gut, they get transmitted, or they get transferred to the salivary gland. So when the infected tick bites to a new host, through the salivary secretion, the organisms are released. Okay, so once the organisms, they are released into a host through the salivary secretion, directly the organisms, they migrate to the nearest lymph node, and then they enter into the monocytes. Majority of times it enters into the monocytes, and they form intracytoplasmic inclusions, and this is of a great importance in diagnosing canine ehrlichiosis. So we call these inclusions are Murrelia. So during the developmental stage in the infected monocytes, you can find a separate, you know, spot along with the nucleus. So this is called as Murrelia. Then after that, once they come out of the along with the infected monocytes, they invade majority of the organ. So that we call it as multi-organ invasion. So majority of the organs, they are infected. So all these, you know, infected monocytes, they carry the organisms to different organs. So which are the organs? Liver is affected, meninges are affected, kidneys are affected. In retinal linings also they have been identified the organisms. In lungs also they are identified as invading type of organism. It also goes to the bone marrow. Okay, so it is a multi-systemic disease. That's what we have to understand, because the organism get, you know, spread to most of the organ, and that's why the clinical signs are also varied. Okay, so we call it as multi-systemic signs. Okay, so not a very one particular type of clinical sign is observed. There are variety of signs observed in the dog affected with canine ehrlichiosis, because there are various organs they are affected by the organism. So in bone marrow, it causes bone marrow suppression. So because of that, all cell count goes down. In lungs, it causes inflammatory type of reaction. So that's why in radiograph, when you take a radiograph of more ehrlichiosis affected dog, you find the inflammatory spots in the chest radiograph. In retina, if you do the examination, ophthalmoscopic examination of the eye, you find the small retinal hemorrhages. So that indicates that it is causing damage to the retina. In kidneys, it causes a type of nephrotic type of changes, and you find the proteinuria also in few cases of canine ehrlichiosis. In liver, also it causes inflammation. In meninges, also it causes inflammation. So like that. So what exactly the canine the ehrlichial organisms they cause in dogs? So it has been observed that they cause endothelial vasculitis. Okay, so there is a endothelial damage. Vasculitis is nothing but the inflammation of the blood vessels. So endothelial vasculitis is the major reason which is expected, or which is the basic pathological change what these organisms they cause. And because of that, the vascular endothelium gets damaged, and because of that, the fluid exceeds, or fluid comes out of the endothelial linings. Apart from that, it has also been documented that they cause a lot of depletion in the platelet count. And so that's why the in diagnosis, we give a lot of emphasis on thrombocytopenia. Okay, so that is nothing but the decreased thrombocyte count is nothing but the platelet count. Okay, and apart from that, it also causes pancytopenia. I told you the bone marrow suppression, it results into the decrease in number of most of the blood cells, including RBCs. So that's why you find pancytopenia. Okay, so this is the basic pathogenesis of canine ehrlichiosis. I will explain you about the clinical findings and the diagnosis and treatment of canine ehrlichiosis. Now let us look into the clinical findings of canine ehrlichiosis. So first you have to understand the disease occurs basically into two forms. One is acute form and the chronic form. And it has been, you know, well documented that the chronic form of ehrlichiosis is much more commonly represented as clinical case than the acute form, because acute form remains there for a very short time. Okay, but let us see what are the different features of acute form. So the acute, the dogs suffering from acute ehrlichiosis will be presented with intermittent fever, there is lethargy, there is weight loss, definitely there will be underlying anorexia also. Occasional epistaxis. So they call it as bleeding tendencies. This you have to understand. Occasional epistaxis. hind limb weakness. Okay, so this hind limb weakness is expressed by wobbling type of gait. Okay, the animal is not able to bear the body weight on hind limbs, so that is called as wobbling. So hind limb weakness is expressed by wobbling type of gait. Then you get swollen lymph nodes. Okay, so usually in other cattle and other things, the prescapular lymph nodes and all, they can be very well palpated. But in dogs, you have to concentrate on popliteal lymph nodes, which are just behind the femur. Okay, so there you have to palpate and see that the lymph node size has been increased or not. So swollen lymph nodes is very distinct in case of acute ehrlichiosis. Then coughing. So these are all clinical signs represented because of the inflammatory changes going on different organs. Okay, so capricious type of means indifferent type of appetite. Capricious type of appetite is also a very distinct feature of acute ehrlichiosis. Now let us concentrate, or let us give emphasis for the chronic form, because it is well said that the chronic ehrlichiosis is more represented in clinical case. Now here, recurrent episodes of fever. Okay, so sometimes the fever will be there continuously for two or three days, then again it will subside for some time, again it will be represented by fever. Now the first thing which you have to keep it in mind, what you do when a dog is presented with fever to your hospital. So normally we say that the animal is having pyrexia. So it is presumed that probably the animal is affected with some infectious agent, and because of that the pyrexia is being represented, isn't it? So when fever is there, what you do? Normally we give one antibiotic, and we send the case. So maybe for 2 or 3 days, either on first day you give injectable antibiotic, for 2 or 3 days you advise the owner to give oral antibiotic and antibiotic. Okay, so if it is by some viral agent, by bacterial agent, you will find that the dog responds to your treatment. Okay, and the case gets okay in about 3-4 days, 5 days of time. Okay, sometimes 3 days treatment, sometimes 5 days treatment. But here, in spite of giving antibiotic, you find that the fever doesn't respond. Okay, so that is called as a relapsing type of fever, or that is called as non-responding type of fever. So always, whenever a dog is represented with recurrent fever without, you know, any change, in spite of giving antibiotic, the first thing it should flash in your mind that probably you are suspecting, or you are treating, or you are getting a case of canine ehrlichiosis. So recurrent episodes of fever is a very distinct feature of canine ehrlichiosis. Okay, and that's what I have already underlined there. No response to common antibiotic. Okay, then slowly there is development of edema. Okay, so try to remember the pathogenesis. Okay, so there is a vasculitis, endothelial damage. So because of that, the fluid comes out of the system or through the blood vessels. And where this fluid will go? So this fluid will accumulate gravitationally. So wherever dependent parts are there, you can find edema. So dependent part means especially the edema is prominent in hind limbs. Even it can also be seen around the scrotal. So scrotal edema, edema of hind limbs is very distinct cardinal feature of canine ehrlichiosis. Then disorientation, depression, head and neck tumors. This is because of the involvement of nervous system. So these type of signs are also seen in few dogs affected with canine ehrlichiosis. Then spontaneous bleeding tendencies. Okay. So one we have seen, the epistaxis. So any dog with epistaxis should be suspected for canine ehrlichiosis. This doesn't happen only in the bleeding occurring through the nose. Epistaxis is nothing but the bleeding through the nose. This bleeding can occur even in subcutaneous tissues also. So you can find petechial or ecchymotic patches on the underlying skin, especially on the abdomen. Okay, so this is because of the spontaneous bleeding tendency. And why this happens? This happens because of the thrombocytopenia and vascular damage. Okay, so what the thrombocytes they do? Thrombocytes, they aggregate wherever the injury is there, isn't it? And they are the first line in clotting, isn't it? So when the blood clot has to be formed, first stage is thrombocytic aggregation or accumulation. isn't it? Clumping up thrombocytes. And then the blood clotting factors, factor 1, factor 2, factor 3, factor 4, whatever factors are there, they combinedly form a clot and thereby the bleeding stops. But this doesn't happen in canine ehrlichiosis because of the thrombocytopenia. So the platelets are decreased. So there is no platelet aggregation, which we say that it is the first step in blood clotting. So when that doesn't happen, the bleeding tendencies are increased. So this bleeding can occur anywhere in the body, even in the meninges also. Okay. So this bleeding can occur anywhere. So you find the cutaneous, petechial or ecchymotic type of patches, epistaxis. Sometimes internal bleeding is also seen in case of canine ehrlichiosis. So you get the dogs which are passing black colored stools. Okay, or there could be even frank hematochezia, that is frank blood in the feces. Okay, so that you have to understand. So any dog which is showing epistaxis or spontaneous bleeding tendencies should be suspected for canine ehrlichiosis. So is it clear? Clinical findings are very distinct and they are identifiable. Let us go to diagnosis. Now this is a very difficult type of situation of diagnosing canine ehrlichiosis, because we say that the ehrlichia, they are only seen in the mononuclear cells, especially the monocytes, okay, or sometimes in the lymphocytes, sometimes in the polymorphs also. But the problem is these cells are very less in number. Apart from that, there is a pancytopenia. The total cell in the blood circulation has gone down because of the infection. So that's why demonstration of Murli in mononuclear cell, which is considered to be the most important diagnostic feature of canine ehrlichiosis, is little bit not easy to in routine things. So that's why I have given the yesterday one article was shared with you on WhatsApp. So that Dr. Rupali, she did her MBSC on canine ehrlichiosis under my guidance. So she has done a lot of work. So we basically emphasized on diagnosis and treatment of canine ehrlichiosis. So what she did, all the dogs which were suspected for canine ehrlichiosis, we, carried out 3 simultaneous examination and we just compared which diagnostic technique is more sure or more confirmatory for the diagnosis of canine ehrlichiosis. So routine blood smear examination. So when I take a drop of blood, make a smear stain with routine dyes like Jimsa or Leishman and try to see whether you get a Murli in the circulating monocytes or lymphocytes or even in neutrophils, isn't it? So if you get, you are lucky. But as you know, the cells are distributed so many and then you may have to search at least 100, 200 fields to see that whether all their lymphocytes or monocytes, they are free of Murli or not. You may get 1 or 2. Okay. So the chances of detecting a Murli in a peripheral blood smear are very, very less. Then we tried the other method. So whether we can concentrate the WBCs and stain them and try to see. Okay. The chances are more. Okay. So what we did, we centrifuged the blood sample and we separated the buffy coat. So what is buffy coat? Buffy coat is nothing but the congregation of leukocytes, isn't it? So this buffy coat means the chances are more. You are separating the leukocytes by centrifuging the blood sample, and this buffy coat you are taking on a slide, making a smear of buffy coat and then staining it. Okay. So the chances of getting more lymphocytes at one place and then staining it and then trying to find out whether the Murli they are present or not. So the chances of diagnosing in a canine ehrlichiosis gets enhanced if you make a buffy coat smear and stain it and try to see. Okay, but nowadays lot of diagnostic kits are being marketed, and one of the kit which she used is SD4X. And that was marketed by IDX. It is an American company. And this has come to handy for the diagnosis of ehrlichiosis. So it is basically an ELISA-based diagnostic kit. And this diagnostic kit which she has used has proven to be 100% effective. So the 16 dogs which she screened, all of them they were positive for this SD4X kit. Okay, so it detects four or five antigens at once. That is the advantage of that. Only the cost is the major issue. Each kit cost around 900 to 1000 rupees. So it becomes little costly, but it is highly confirmatory. Okay, so here in that article also you can see a spot has been spot you can identify. It is a spot test. Okay, so this in spot test basically you can see it has got a sample window where the plasma or the whole blood also can be used wherever you are suspecting the dog is suffering from canine ehrlichiosis. So you have to collect the blood sample. So the whole blood also can be used with anti-clot factor, or so you can even separate the plasma and use it, or you can separate the serum also. Okay, because it is antibody based ELISA kit. Okay, but that you need not have to depend on the ELISA reader. Here it is spot. Okay, so the test kit has been designed in such a way that whatever the antibodies, if they are present in the sample, they migrate to the diagnostic window, and there a specific antigen related spot has been created. So when the antibodies, they react with the antigen, some dyes or substrate is there which will give a staining. So if the antigen antibody reaction is taking place, it is along with the substrate and a coloring agent, it will give a blue spot. Okay, so this blue spot, if it appears within maybe less than 3 to 4 minutes, it is considered to be positive. And that has become very handy, and that is the need of the hour. And we are getting, we can diagnose canine ehrlichiosis in less than 5 minutes. Okay, so that is very useful in the field. So no need of any instrument or anything of that sort. The kit is self-explanatory. It comes with a distinct kit is supplied with a dropper and the reagent. So you have to just put the sample in the sample window and then press it and then wait for about 4 or 5 minutes. So within 5 minutes, if you get a blue spot designated, okay, because it detects 4 different antigens, designated spots are there. So the blue coloration spot, if it appears at Ehrlichia canis, the test is positive. Okay, so if you go through that article, it is well explained also. Okay, so you can read once again that article and you will get more information about spot diagnosis of canine ehrlichiosis. Now there are few advanced diagnostic techniques are also available for diagnosis of canine ehrlichiosis, like Western blot. Then even a dedicated PCR probe is also available for diagnosis of canine ehrlichiosis, but they are all advanced diagnostic techniques. What you have to look into is the commonest type of diagnostic kits. Diagnostic approaches are routine blood smear examination, but the efficacy is very low, less than I think 15% probability. Then if you do the other way, you have to separate the buffy coat, stain with routine dyes, azure dyes, and try to see. The chances they get more, so around 35% to 40% efficacy is there. But this spot test is more effective and it is 100% reliable. So it can also be used in the field also, because it doesn't require any more instrumentation. Okay, so that is about the diagnosis of canine ehrlichiosis. Apart from that, if the clinical case is available, you should try to identify the tick also. Okay, so tick, it is a tick-borne disease. It is a vector-borne disease. So if the tick is available on the body, you try to see which tick is specifically involved. And in about 80% to 90% of the cases, it will come out to be the erysipelas. So you have to correlate erysipelas on the body and then the diagnosis by detecting the maruli in the circulating monocytes or lymphocytes. And if you have the kit, specific kit, you can go for the ELISA-based kit also. Then apart from that, one more thing which you have to concentrate is thrombocytopenia. So low platelet count. So if you have an automated blood cell counter, you will get the platelet count also. So the normal platelet count should be more than 1.5 lakhs and it can go up to 5 lakhs also. So any platelet count which is less than 1.5 lakhs, it is a clear-cut indication that there is a thrombocytopenia, and thrombocytopenia is an indirect indication of canine ehrlichiosis. Now let us go to the next slide, that is treatment of ehrlichiosis. So the drug of choice for the treatment of ehrlichiosis is oxytetracycline. Okay, so this oxytetracycline can be given in two ways. Okay, so it can be given at the rate of 22 milligram per kg body weight intravenously. Okay, so people have used for about 11 days of oxytetracycline intravenously at the rate of 22 milligram per kg body weight. But in our study, what we did, because repeated presentation of the case becomes a difficult situation, so what we did for first 2 days, we gave 22 milligram per kg of oxytetracycline intravenously for first 2 days, and that was followed by the more appropriate treatment is doxycycline. Oxytetracycline can also be given, but it causes lot of irritation to the gastric mucosa. So because of that, the doxycycline is a better choice. Okay, so first 2 days you treat the case with oxytetracycline at the rate of 22 milligram per kg body weight by intravenous route, and followed by doxycycline at the rate of 5 to 10 milligram per kg body weight orally for at least 21 days, at least 3 weeks. Keep it in mind. It is a long time treatment. Even some of the reviews, some of the books, they say that the treatment has to be kept continued for about 6 to 8 weeks. But what we have in Rupali's research, we came out with a proposal that 3 weeks treatment with doxycycline. Initially for 2 days, you give oxytetracycline intravenously, followed by doxycycline for 21 days. And most of the dogs, they become negative after 16th or 17th day. And they continue to remain negative even after 21 days. Okay, so that is the basic treatment available and we are following it. Parenteral imidacloprid also has been indicated and it is better than the oxytetracycline. So the dose rate is 5 to 7 milligram per kg body weight. All these days this imidacloprid dipropionate was not available in India, but recently few pharmaceutical companies, they got a license and it is available in the market, and it can be given at the rate of 5 to 7 milligram per kg body weight. Okay, by subcutaneous or intramuscular. Then few research workers, they have reported that the azithromycin, or we can call it as macrolide antibiotics, they are also having efficacy against canine ehrlichiosis, but it is in experimental stage, so that's why we are not discussing it. But azithromycin and clarithromycin have also shown some good results in the treatment of canine ehrlichiosis. So time being, either oxytetracycline, doxycycline therapeutic regimen has to be followed for the treatment of canine ehrlichiosis, or the other alternative is imidacloprid dipropionate. Sometimes, few field veterinarians, they have reported that after giving imidacloprid to the dogs, there is a lot of salivation. So that is it's not a anaphylactic type of reaction, but salivation has been seen in dogs with imidacloprid. But if you compare the imidacloprid with doxycycline, oxytetracycline therapy, imidacloprid has shown better results. One thing is, it need not to be repeated. It is only on single dose. After 14 days, you examine the animal. If still you find morally, if one more dose of imidacloprid can be repeated on 14th day. Otherwise, one dose of imidacloprid is enough. Whereas in oxytetracycline, doxycycline therapy, the treatment has to be continued for 3 consecutive weeks. Okay, for 21 days. So that is the disadvantage. But efficacy-wise, it has been reported that imidacloprid is better than oxytetracycline, doxycycline therapy. Okay, this is about the treatment of canine ehrlichiosis. Now, they say that a short tapering course of prednisolone is also helpful in the treatment of canine ehrlichiosis. So, prednisolone is a corticosteroid low potency cefixitride, you can call it as, when compared to dexamethasone and betamethasone. It can be given at the rate of 5 mg per kg body weight or 10 mg per kg body weight. So a short tapering course, it causes immunosuppression. Basically, it has been observed that if you cause an immunosuppression in a canine ehrlichiosis case, you get better results. Apart from that, prednisolone also has been known to improve the thrombocytic count. Okay, so on both counts, it has been advocated that short tapering course of prednisolone is also helpful in the treatment of canine ehrlichiosis. Then you have to concentrate on the hemoglobin levels also. If the hemoglobin drops below 6 g/cl, the case requires blood transfusion. Okay, so this also you have to keep it in mind. Not only treating the canine ehrlichiosis, if there is a very low hemoglobin, if the hemoglobin means basically the hemoglobin, if it is falling below 6 g, there is a requirement that the blood transfusion needs to be given on priority. Second, the third point to be kept it in mind is tick control, because we have understood it is a tick-borne disease, it is a vector-borne disease. So when you treat the case and if you don't look at the tick control, again there is a possibility of relapse. So that's why tick control also should be kept it in mind in treatment of canine ehrlichiosis. Now, again, there is a this is a what you can call it as advice, which type of anti-inflammatory agent should be used in the treatment of canine ehrlichiosis, because there is already thrombocytic, the low thrombocytic count is there. Some of the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, they further deplete the thrombocytic count. Okay, so that's why they say that diclofenac should be avoided. So in human also, it has been proven beyond doubt that the dengue fever, which has got a hemorrhagic tendencies, so the diclofenac should not be used. A plain paracetamol will be a better use. So you have nimesulide, you have meloxicam, so they are better NSAIDs than the diclofenac. So if you want to use it as antipyretic, the preference should be given to meloxicam and paracetamol over diclofenac. So this is the in nutshell the canine ehrlichiosis we have seen. So we have understood the origin of canine ehrlichiosis, the history and background, and its relation with outbreaks of canine ehrlichiosis during the IPKF which was sent to Sri Lanka. So there, actually, the Indian in scenario, the insurgents or the sudden increase in the cases of ehrlichiosis was observed when a lot of military dogs, which were used for sniffer operation, the disease came into the prominence. Then we have seen the etiology of canine ehrlichiosis, and the most important organism, that is Ehrlichia canis, responsible for canine ehrlichiosis. Then we have studied the pathogenesis, how the disease develops, and what are the pathological changes it causes, and we try to bring its correlation with the clinical findings. Okay, and then we have studied how the canine ehrlichiosis can be diagnosed by different methods and what is the treatment protocol. So in nutshell, we have covered the canine ehrlichiosis in detail. Thank you very much.